in today's video, we're going to be doing something that I've needed to do for a very, very long time. This is the AGA. Everyone has seen the AGA before. It's 75 years old. I completely restored it from basically what was a pile of scrap to working condition. Now, when I built the AGA before Christmas, there was one part that I ordered from England and it never arrived. It was sent to France on a pallet and the courier company lost the pallet. So when I built the AGA at Christmas, there was one part that was faulty. It only had probably about a year left in it, but I used it anyway and we've been using the AGA ever since, but it's finally broken. So the AGA, instead of being a nice cooking temperature and you've been able to control the temperature, it's actually getting too hot. And there was actually one stage where this main hot plate here was glowing orange, and that's not meant to happen. So what's happening is air is getting into the fire from somewhere that it should not be getting in. And the reason for that is because the part where the fire sits has developed a hole. I'll show you that part with a hole in it when I get to it. But what's gonna happen now is I have to replace the inner barrel, as it's called, this part here, very heavy cast iron part. This is a new one that I managed to get sent over from England. My parents went to a wedding, my cousin's wedding in England. Just before they went, the AGA broke. So I managed to get the company that supply these spare parts to rush one to my aunt's house so that my parents could collect it and bring it back. So we now have, it's not a brand new one, obviously this one has been used, but it's in better condition than the one that's in there. So this is the AGA in a barrel and the fire sits in the bottom. The hot plate here sits on top and in the bottom is a grate. So that's where the fire sits and the one that's in there is it's 75 years old and it's knackered. I've got to take this top off. I've got to take these hot plates out, which are very heavy. This one alone needs two people to lift it. I've got to take all the insulation out of the AGA to get to the innards so that I can replace this part. So the first thing I'm gonna have to do, you've got these little chrome buttons and they just unscrew like this. To take them out, one here. And I've got a special tool. This is a special AGA screwdriver that fits in here and it's made of iron. So I've just got to unscrew these. They're basically like bolts that secure the top. There's rods that go from here right the way through to the base and that holds everything together. So we've got to take those out before we can do anything. What I need to do now is, if you can help me, Andrew, is I need to lift this top off and put it on the table out of the way. That is very heavy. Go put that down. I want to lift this very carefully off.
Okay.
Yep, have you got it? There we go, that's the whole top of the AGA off. There's a rod. Can you see these rods here? They go right to the base of the AGA. Now this one, it's got stuck. So as I unscrew this, it's actually unscrewing the rod, which is into the bottom, and then it's going to be impossible to get it back in. So I need to get a grip under here. Oh, there we go. That's it. Grip that to stop it turning underneath and then take this one off. That should be free now. It wants a bit of oil when I put it back. So then we can remove the corner plates. Now the reason for this corner plate is that these AGAs used to come in two models. You'd have the AGA standard C, which is just for cooking, which would have no holes in this part. And you would have the model CB, which is a cooker boiler, and the boiler would be down next to the where the fire is. And you'd have two holes in here, which is a different part, and then you'd have two copper pipes coming out, which were for the hot and cold water to go in and out of the boiler. But this one is not gonna have a boiler in it. I decided for now, until the cottage is completely finished, that I can't have this cooker cooking and their hot water not being used, going through a system. So for now, there's no boiler gonna be in this one. Right, so what I need to do now is take out all of this. Let's take the hot plate off. This is the simmering plate. So the thing is, when I actually built this AGA before Christmas, I built it in one night alone. because I was in a rush. I needed to get the AGA built so that the kitchen could be installed so that we could have Christmas dinner in here. At that time, I didn't have anyone to help me film. So I filmed a little bit at the start of me building it, but I ended up just finishing it by myself alone and I couldn't film it. So nobody actually got to see the insides of this thing and how it's put together. And obviously I don't have an AGA engineer to do it for me. So I had to learn how to build this thing myself. So this is the ceramic wool insulation that keeps the heat inside the cooker. And it's quite fragile. So I need to take it out because it's got to go back in later on. So that's the first bit. So for now, this can lay out on the grass. There we go. The stuff on top of the oven doesn't need to come out because I haven't got to deal with that side of it. But I've got to take all of them. I'm going to have to get a bag, actually. So all of this stuff can just be thrown in the bin and replaced later on. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put on this extractor fan. So any dust in the air will get drawn out. You might be able to hear it in the background, though, unfortunately. Now, underneath the rock wool is a product called vermiculite. Now, it's actually made from fossilized seabeds, and it's an incredibly good insulator because it's in granule form, so you can pour it into the AGA and it'll fill all of the spaces that need to be filled, which stops the heat getting out. Look at that. You can take this outside and dump it somewhere and then fill up another bucket full. You can go on the old junk pile. So we're now finally inside the AGA. Now on closer inspection, this is the barrel sealing rope that actually stops the, it seals the gap between the ash pit and the fire, and it's absolutely shot, crumbled to pieces. But thankfully we have a replacement. Yeah, it's all fallen to pieces. So that's one of the reasons why the air is getting into the fire. I suppose it's good actually, that means this whole thing's going to have a good service. This has got to come off. And then this. And we've got to try and keep the relevant screws with the relevant pieces because they're all slightly different sizes. Now if you look here, when the AGA is below cooking temperature, this should be open, this little lever here. And that lets air in into the fire. And when the cooker comes up to temperature, this wire here, it's filled with mercury, it should expand and push that shut, which cuts off the air to the fire. And that little hole there should be the only place that air can get into the fire. And now at the moment, air is getting in somewhere else because the part of the AGA where the fire is, obviously there's a hole somewhere. So we have a problem. Vacuum out this dust. What I need to do is remove this carefully, very carefully, because it's quite delicate. That's got to come out. There we go. That can just sit in there like that, that's no problem. Would you now be able to help me, Andrew? I need to lift out this hot plate and it's very, very heavy. You ready? Under here. One, two, three. Up, straight down onto the floor, there we go. Whoa, that is the heaviest part of the AGA. You can see, well, this, apart from all the, yeah, there's a hole just there. So this part is completely at the end of its life and needs to be replaced. These are all imperial spanners, and so they are obviously the ones you need for building this AGA, because obviously it was, this was built in the 1940s. The metric nuts and bolts, they don't fit. I'll tell you what I've got. I've got my 1940s spanner here, which actually in the instructions, the building instructions for this, I actually managed to find the original 1940s instructions of how to build this. It actually recommends this specific spanner here. I suppose you would call it a wrench maybe in the States, but we call them spanner. We're about to free the inner barrel from the top roasting oven. So yeah, actually building one of these things is really technical. There's a lot of things that you've got to think about, and you've got to know how everything fits together so that it's not only put together, but it's actually safe to use, you know, because obviously it's got a fire inside it. So if it's not built properly, you know, it could be quite dangerous. But obviously, luckily, I've done so much research and I've built and taken apart so many of these over the years that I actually taught myself how to do it. So that's now free. Let's pull that out so that it's not going to get damaged. There we go. This should now lift out. Oh, there we go. And there it is. The offending part, the part that's damaged. You can see they're basically exactly the same, but if you turn them over, that's when you can see. Ah, look, see? Ah. All of this soot on the outside shouldn't be here. And that means that smoke has been escaping into this area, which is not meant to happen. Let's take this out. This is the heat seal rope, which is absolutely perished. Look at that. See that hole? That is not good. That should not be happening. Yeah. So air is getting through there as well. And there may be some other holes. The metal feels very thin. There's a blob of fire cement on either side here. That needs to be removed so we can put some fresh stuff in there. I haven't seen any of this since before Christmas. I was in such a rush to build it and it was so late at night that I really can't even remember the whole process. There we go, gone. Let's take these bits out as well. Absolutely perfect, there we go. I'm gonna have a good clear up in there because it's all full of absolute rubbish. And then we can move on to the next stage. Okay, so that was 3 hours since we last filmed. If you come and have a look, I've put the new barrel in, the outer barrel, which contains the base of the fire, I've lowered the ash pit by about 10 millimeters. What was happening before was this barrel, as it heats up, it expands, the bottom part expands and pushes downwards. And if there's not enough clearance for it to push down into the ash pit, what happens is the whole barrel pushes itself up. And what was happening, this hot plate was rising up very slightly, only by a few millimeters. And it wasn't level once the AGA was hot. So I've lowered that, so that's given it a bit of tolerance now. I've put the new ash pit sealing rope in, which stops the air getting into the fire. Everything's been leveled up. I put the thermostat back, I put the thermometer back as well, and it's now time to refill this thing with insulation. So I've got some bags outside, I'm gonna go and get that, and I'm gonna start pouring it in. But before I do that, I'm just gonna wedge a little bit of insulation just between this block here that presses against the barrel. And I'm going to wedge another little piece this side against it to wedge it against the barrel so it's making perfect contact. I don't know if we had a bit of a problem. One of the microphones ran out of battery because we've been doing this thing for so long. Yeah, where's all, there, look, let's get all the insulation down behind there. I tell you, it just disappears into the abyss. A well-insulated AGA, packed properly with insulation, will use much less fuel and put far less heat out into the room. Because although the AGA is meant to irradiate heat into the room, sometimes it can radiate too much and you end up with a really hot room. And we don't want that. We want just a nice gentle heat coming off this thing and all of the heat to be retained and pushed towards the ovens, which is where it should be. There we go. Right, you remember that was filled almost to the top last time. So it's time for another bag because it's all gone down into the cooker where it belongs. Bag number two. Oops. Luckily we've got a vacuum cleaner. Let's sort that out. There we go. I'm sure there's something in the 1940s instructions about ramming it gently home. That's what we're doing. Ramming it home. Hoping that because I've used less of this modern insulation, obviously this stuff around the ovens is fantastic because it offers far more insulation than the original stuff does. A piece of this is the equivalent to probably about that much vermiculite, so it's much more efficient. So around the ovens is great because you don't want all that heat escaping from that side of the cooker to the back. That's fine, but the spaces down between here and the side of the ovens, I'm going to do it differently this time. As I said, I want to put less of that insulation, you know, the ceramic wood insulation, and use more of this, what they would have originally used. So you'll get far more similar result insulation wise to when this thing was brand new 75 years ago. There we go, last pour. Should take all two bags if we've done it right. There we go. The wonders of fossilized seabeds. This is how I cut rock wool, especially if it's thick stuff like this. Use a saw.
Works wonders. There we go. Right, we don't want the paper on it. Let's take some of this in. This is the horrible itchy part. There we go. Lovely. Look at that. Let's pull some more bits off. And we'll put a little bit more in these spaces, and then I'm going to go and get the original ceramic wall insulation, pop that back. Billy has informed me that in the distance there is a huge, huge, huge lightning storm on its way. So that'll be quite exciting as we're lighting the AGA. Oh, it's like a woolly blanket. Keep it nice and warm. Keep all that heat in. It's actually rock. It's, what they do is they get rock and they melt it until it's liquid. I think it's a type of volcanic rock. And they put it in a centrifuge. Same way you make candy floss. Obviously you melt sugar, put it in the center, and it spins and it creates the floss. But they do the same exact same process, but with rock. And you get your glass wool insulation. This is far more efficient. It's the best stuff. That goes there. And there should be a piece that goes under the back here. Maybe that's it. All these little pieces. There should be one more piece out here. Simmering plate. There we go. I tell you, not much heat's going to escape out of there. Just what we want, a little bit. Perfect, look at that. Now they say it should be sat slightly higher than the front. Maybe I'll put a piece there to raise it up. And a piece under there. Let's get rid of all of these bits. Right back. There we go. It's okay. Right, I'll do the adjustments from here. After much messing around, I've managed to get these things back in line. And we can screw them down now. It's pretty flush. Now, this thing's 75 years old. All the parts have warped. It's had new castings here. It's had new castings there. But look at that. You see that? That's flush. And that means something I've never been able to do before, because it wasn't level before, is that the good thing about an AGA is obviously the hot plate's very, very hot. If you want to move your pan half on, half off, we can do that now, because you know you can have half the pan on, so it's a lot gentler, the heat. So finally, we are there. Actually, let's put this the simmering plate back in, and we can get an idea of how much we need to screw this side down. Is it flush? This one might be slightly off. Ah, literally we're talking like not even a millimeter. Maybe if I spin it round, because there are tolerances within these things. Yep, we're good, front to back as well. It's a little bit high at the back, but it really doesn't matter. It's as good as we're gonna get. It's far better than it was before. So, now, oh, it's never looked so good. Now that goes on. There it is. Once it's on, it sort of snaps into place. Now this is gonna need recalibrating, because we've got new insulation, we've got where everything's new basically. So once this is lit and up to temperature, I will have to, as I said, recalibrate this. But for now, let's get it back on. Now the only thing that's missing on the instructions, which are scans of the originals, is the distance in millimeters that that disc should be from that piece of metal when this is set to 2. So we don't know what that is. We can make some fine adjustments. That should, if you look here now, you see the lever is set to 2, and there's just maybe a 2 millimeter gap there, see? Close it, that'll close, but obviously there's no heat pushing through this cable at the minute, so it's not gonna put any pressure on it, but when it does, but as you can see, set it to 3, set it to 4, set it to 5. And that's how you can control the temperature. It's time for me to clear up and light this thing. So I'm gonna go sort this mess out, go and have a shower, and then we'll come back and we'll light it. And we should be by the time it's lit, we should be about 2 o'clock in the morning, but there's nothing else to do. So yeah, job well done, I'm pleased with that. I just need some more rope.